Soft Engineering Radio, episode 135, Introduction to Software Configuration Management.
This is Software Engineering Radio, the podcast for professional developers on the web at se-radio.net. SE Radio brings you relevant and detailed discussions and interviews on software engineering topics every 10 days. Thanks to our audience and the partners listed on our website for support.
Welcome to a new show on Software Engineering Radio. Our topic today is software configuration management. My name is Michael and my guest today is Petri Ahonen from Finland. Welcome, Petri.
Hello.
Petri, briefly introduce yourself to our listeners.
I work for a company called Design Combus, which is a company in the business of manufacturing and designing networking equipment. My role there is managing the product development, engineering, and I've been working in different software engineering related positions for the last 13 years.
How did you come up with software configuration management as a topic for SE Radio?
Actually, I did propose a discussion topic for the software engineering get-together event last year. It's a shame that the event got cancelled, but I'm glad that we have the opportunity for this podcast.
What is your involvement with software configuration management in your daily life?
Well, I've never been a full-time SEM expert per se, but I've always found it to be an important tool in the software projects, and I think it has a significant role in the success or failure of projects.
How would you define software configuration management and what it's all about?
Software configuration management is the tools and processes to manage the evolution of a software product. In this context, with software product, I mean a configuration of components or configuration items. These configuration items are typically, for example, source files or build scripts or anything that affects the software product.
Why do you think software configuration management is necessary? Not that I need to be convinced, but it's for sure interesting for our listeners to get your experience on that.
Well, in my personal experience, the most important reasons for software configuration management are the identification, component sharing, and concurrent development. These are the things that I have found personally the most important. I'm sure in different industries there are very different requirements and perspectives for SCM, but for the embedded software projects that I've been working with, these are the ones that I have found most important.
You mentioned identification. What do you mean by identification?
By identification, I mean the relationship from a specific configuration to its configuration items. Or, in other words, the relationship of software product and its source artifacts, the stuff that it's made of. For example, when we manufacture a device, it always has a specific image of our software programmed into it. Each image is labeled with a version identification from which we can later determine which features and which bugs are there in this device.
You also mentioned component sharing and concurrent development.
Yes, when you're working with a software, when you're working with a product that is implemented in software, you're actually working with a number of similar but still slightly different software products. You have the latest and greatest version of your product, which has all the latest features and perhaps all the latest bugs as well. Then you have a number of versions of the of your product that you have already released in the past or deployed at a customer. While these versions might not be actively developed anymore, you still need to be able to troubleshoot and fix bugs on those as well. On the other hand, these are all efforts that need to be isolated. And on the other hand, you need to be able to eliminate duplicate efforts while working with very similar products.
Okay, so in the following, we want to go through a set of definitions of typical terms in software configuration management. By that, we also would like to explain how those terms are used, how those concepts are actually used. So, Petri, I give you the keywords and you define them. Is that okay?
Okay.
Source file or configuration item?
Yes. A source file is probably the most typical configuration item in a software product. But in general, any component that affects the software product should be considered as a configuration item. For example, compilation scripts, any configuration files or descriptors, documentation, and even artwork are examples of configuration items. Also, software components such as libraries should also be considered as configuration items.
Repository?
Repository is a place to store your configurations and the configuration items. It's like a database.
Commit, or it's also called revision or change set?
Yes, commit is a modification to a set of source files in a repository. I think most of the tools nowadays treat commits as an atomic set of modifications, so that when you check in, when you commit a change to a set of files, all those changes are applied, or none of them are applied at once. In addition to the changes themselves, a commit typically carries important metadata as well, such as who made the commit, when was the commit made, and a text message describing what is the commit about.
Then the term workspace.
Workspace is a personal copy of all the configuration items needed to build the software product, like the complete source tree for your software project. These workspaces should be always kept separate, in the sense that you should never share workspaces among developers, and while you can use multiple workspaces for yourselves as well, you should keep them separate as well. This will save you from trouble later when committing your changes back to the repository.
A tag or a baseline?
A tag is a name that is assigned to a complete set of files, source files that are required to build the software product. The set of files is frozen in the sense that once the name is assigned, the contents can no longer be changed. It's like a name snapshot in time. An example of a tag could be a released version of a software product. These tags can be manually assigned with a human assigned name, or these tags could be implicitly generated by the tools.
A code line or branch?
A code line is similar to a tag in the sense that it is a name that is assigned to the complete set of source files, but it is an evolving set. So that while the code line is being developed, the commits introduce changes to the files, but the name of the code line stays the same. Typical examples of code lines are mainline and or trunk code lines for active development and release code lines for maintenance. Each code line should have a different policy. These policies depend on the purpose of the code line, these policies define what kind of changes are allowed in a code line. A code line is typically implemented as a branch in the tools, and tools may assist you with enforcing your policies on the code lines using techniques like pre-commit hooks or similar.
Then the term build?
But the term build, I understand two different concepts. First, build is the process of turning your configuration into a software product. It's about the compilation, the linking, packaging, all the stuff that is completely automated. On the other hand, this resulting package is often called a build.
Original source?
I would like to make a clear separation of original source and intermediate files. This can be both configuration items within the software configuration management, but the original source are those files that cannot be generated from other files. They are the ones that are human made and require human effort to create. The intermediate files are those that may be in fact quite similar, but they can be generated from the original source. I think it's in the ideal scenario, these intermediate files would always be generated when needed during the build, but at least they should be clearly separated from the original source. I do know that this is not always feasible to build everything from the scratch all over again, but as the intermediate files are basically a caching exercise, it should at least be controlled by tools as trying to manage the relationship of the original source and the intermediate files is, in my opinion, a recipe for trouble.
So in summary, you don't advise to cache or store any intermediate files because you will very easily get inconsistencies, right?
Exactly. It makes it harder to identify what the product is made of if you have these intermediate files in between. And I understand that it might not be always feasible to build everything from the scratch all the time, but at least trying to keep them separated so that the original source are in a different location than intermediate files, so that you won't accidentally get them into an inconsistent state. That would be a helpful strategy.
And for the build, you mentioned automated build, so you should really automate everything, right?
Yes, I think it's very important that the build can be performed completely automated, so that it is repeatable, that the same source always produces the same product, and the sense that everyone can invoke the build process with minimal effort, so that they can try out any changes and still trust that the changes that they made are the only ones that are affecting the software product.
In the definition of code line, you mentioned the term branch. What is your experience with branches? How intensive should you use branches?
Certainly you shouldn't overuse those branches, at least with tools that have limited support for merging those branches. It's often easy to branch, but merging back those branches might be too costly in some cases.
Okay, thanks for the definitions. We don't want to go into any tools discussion, but Petri, please iterate briefly on what kind of tools you need for software configuration management.
I think there are two sides to this. First, you need the actual SCM tool to store your configuration, but I think equally important is the build tool as well, so that you can turn your configurations into a finished product. There are a lot of SCM tools that each have a different scopes and functionality, but mostly the SCM tools are independent of your technology in your application. All the tools can deal with any kind of artifacts as long as they are represented as text. Binary formats are always a bit more complicated, but as long as your sources are in text format, the tools don't really care that much. On the other hand, the build tools are more often specific to your technology and platform, or even programming languages. But regardless of which tools you use for building, I think it's important that everyone is using the same tools.
A brief question on your statement that binary formats are a bit more complicated. I guess it's the merging, because that's next to impossible with binary components.
Yes, exactly. Not only the merging, but taking out the differences of binary files without actually understanding the contents doesn't make much sense. So in theory, I think you could have binary artifacts in your SCM, and you could see differences and even merge changes if you had specialized tools for your format, but these SCM tools typically only handle the text.
Then with the build tools, what are your favorite build tools? What kind of tools you use? Do you use for building and for automating?
Personally, in our environment, I use mostly makefiles and shell scripts for the building.
Okay. Then we had a brief discussion on centralized versus distributed software configuration management. So what are really the differences, and what is this all about, the centralized versus distributed model of software configuration management?
In a centralized system, you have a single repository that is located on a server, and each of the clients then access this repository over a network and send and receive modifications to and from the repository. The server can enforce the integrity of the repository, and typical examples of this kind of centralized tools are, for example, Subversion and Perforce. In distributed systems, all the workspaces actually have a clone of the whole repository as well. There is no central server, and the modifications are propagated between peers. As there is no central server to enforce the integrity of the repository, the use of cryptographic hash functions is used for establishing the relationships within these repositories. Git is an example of this kind of distributed SCM tool. It would have been an interesting topic for the get-together to discuss first-hand experience of different tools.
So where do you see the advantage of the such centralized tools, and where do you see the advantage of distributed software configuration management tools?
I have little experience with the distributed tools, and that's what I would have like to discuss in the get-together. But the greatest promise in the distributed SCM tools is, in my opinion, the merging capabilities and the fact that the complete repository is always available, and this means that the complete history is retained all the time, and this should help the merging, which is possibly an easier effort when you have the complete history available at all times.
Okay. How do you use these tools to enable the concurrent development of both experimental and release versions of your product?
I use different code lines to separate these. I'm sure there are a lot of different approaches to managing the code lines, but what I'm most familiar with is the mainline model, where you have a single code line called mainline or trunk that always represents the latest evolution of your product. Other code lines are branched off from this mainline, and this can be, for example, release code lines or development code lines. The mainline code line evolves forever. All the features are implemented in there, and typically the mainline must always be buildable and pass a set of regression tests. A release code line is used for stabilizing and testing a version of the software that is to be delivered externally, and later it can be used for debugging and fixing important bugs on the versions that are already deployed. From these release code lines, the bug fixes can then be merged back to the mainline. But other than these fixes, the release code lines do not evolve any further. A development code line is a code line that can be used for a development effort that needs to be isolated for the mainline for some reason. For example, when you have a policy that the mainline must always compile and pass the tests, but you do have a development effort that would break these rules for a period of time, then you can branch off a development code line which has a different policy. When you're done with the changes in the development code line, you can then merge them back to the mainline when you are in line with the mainline policy again.
So basically, you start off with a centralized mainline, would then go into a development code line. In the development code line, you continue till you reach a certain stable state, merge it back to the mainline, And at that point, you might consider shipping that version, that set of changes, that state of your product, and you create a release code line on which you polish your product till it's really high quality and shippable, right?
Exactly. And you don't necessarily have to branch a development code lines all the time, but some changes that don't break so much during development, that don't break other things so much, can be certainly done in the mainline. But for those bigger efforts, it certainly makes sense to use a temporary development code line, and the fact that the releases are always branched off the one single mainline, that actually simplifies a lot of things.
Okay, so with this, you really allow for concurrency. So it doesn't mean that you have to follow that strictly sequentially, but you could have multiple teams develop on the same set of files, basically, in different development code lines.
Exactly.
Okay, so what is your recommendation on how to get started with SCM?
Well, my suggestion is that the very first thing that you do is to automate your build process. That is to make sure that there are no external dependencies, or at least they are minimized, in the sense that all the things that affect your software product, they are all within the SCM repository, and that the product always has the identification that can be used for rebuilding the software from the repository, and you should all set up a workflow or a process for the contributors to follow, and define policies for code lines. But you should start simple and lightweight first. Simplifying tool might not get you very far, but certainly the tools and the documentation may provide sample workflows and guidance on defining your own.
From which tool and what kind of documentation did you personally benefit the most?
What I found very interesting is the documentation on Perforce. And even though the documentation is certainly for the one tool, but these concepts are very, very, very well applicable to other tools as well.
Okay, great. So, any final pearls of wisdom?
I know that there might be people who think that the SCM is a boring subject, and in this case, you might want to do a web search for bisecting for bugs. I think this is a very interesting technique to combine automated testing and software configuration management. I've used this in the past, and I found it a very practical tool, and just knowing about it might help spark interest in SCM as well.
Thanks, Petri. It was a pleasure having you on the show.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks for downloading and listening to Software Engineering Radio. Software Engineering Radio is an educational program brought to you by Hillside Europe. If you want more information about the podcast and all the other episodes, visit our website at se-radio.net. If you want to support us, you can donate to the SE Radio team via the website, or you can advertise for SE Radio, for example, by clicking on the Dig, Reddit, Delicious and /dot buttons. To contact the team, please send email to team@se-radio.net, or if it is specific to an episode, please use the comments facility on the website so other people can react to your comments. This episode of SE Radio, as well as all other episodes, are licensed under a Creative Commons 2.5 license. Please see the website for details. Thanks to Charlie Crow and the PodSafe Music Network for the music used in this show. The song is called Vegas Hard Rock Shuffle.